Michael McCloskey, retired. I no longer have titles, but I'm the author of this latest book, Oregon: A State That Stands Out. Well, I have always been interested in traveling around the state as well as the country and the world to gather a bigger picture and see the diversity of the state. But it's very important to see not only the west side, but the east side too. And even though things are changing rapidly in terms of towns dying, nonetheless, there's still a lot to see. And those stories often aren't well told. In my last book, I told many of those stories. Begin by reminding us of a few key facts about Oregon's geography. It's a state that has the westernmost point in the contiguous United States, Cape Blanco. The deepest lake, Crater Lake. The deepest canyon, Hell's Canyon, shared with Idaho. It's the state that has the most waterfalls of any state. It has the longest coastal sand dunes south of Florence. It features the river that has the most water flowing in on the continent, flowing into the Pacific, the Columbia River. And at the mouth of the Columbia River, we find the roughest sea conditions in the world. And the most water flowing over a waterfall, which is entirely within the United States, is our own Willamette Falls. Niagara is shared with Canada. A gorge which is classified as one of, quote, the top 10 wonders of the world, unquote, is the Columbia Gorge. The largest meteorite ever found in the United States was found here in Oregon. The highest fault escarpment in North America is in Oregon, Abbey Rim. The largest sea caves in the world are the Oregon Sea Lion Caves. When I grew up as a boy here, I heard all about the Oregon Sea Lion Caves, but no one ever said they're the largest in the world. Let's remember a few facts about Oregon history. Merchant seamen and explorers examined the Oregon coast for three centuries before the settlers arrived on the Oregon Trail. They were coming from the Philippines and riding the Japanese current across the Pacific and coming abreast of Oregon and then sailing south to Mexico. And the influx of settlers on the Oregon Trail was one of the largest voluntary migrations in human history. Now, when I say that was from 1840 to 1860. When I say voluntary, I mean it was not caused by war, famine, or pestilence. People chose to do it. Incidentally, some structures from that time still survive. I have a photograph of one of them in the book. Astoria was the first English-speaking settlement west of the Rockies, 1811. The first cattle drive on the west coast was to Oregon in 1837. In 1843, at French Prairie, the conclave of settlers decided by one vote to try to become part of the United States, which eventually, of course, they did. And at that time, they formed the first provisional government. And that provisional government had a militia The Oregon Rifles, 1843. That government minted coins called the Beaver Coins. 6,000 were minted. And that government had an unusual two-sided flag. It was a real government. And Oregon City was the first incorporated city west of the Mississippi, 1844. And for a while in 1848, it had the only federal courthouse on the West Coast. Of course, it was the original capital of the provisional government. And Astoria had the first American post office and customs house west of the Rockies, 1847 and 1852. And as the state developed, it began to set all sorts of records. It established, for instance, the first college in the West, Willamette University, 1842. It built the first iron foundry west of the Rockies in 1867, right here in Lake Oswego, the first in the West. In 1874, shipwrights in North Bend built a clipper ship that set world records for a speedy passage to England, beating the time of comparatively to clipper ships built in New England, built here. It built the nation's first high-tension power lines that ran from Oregon City to Portland in 1889. And then Portland built the first electric streetcars installed on the West Coast, 1889 too. And the federal government set up its first wildlife refuge in the West, right here in Oregon, at Three Arch Rocks in 1907 on our coast. And while the settlers were building cities and building steamboats and building railroads, the last of the Indian Wars was still going on over in the Wallawa Valley in the late 1870s against Chief Joseph. Chief Joseph and his band refused to sign a treaty and outmaneuvered the U.S. Army for weeks on end until they finally surrendered at the Canadian border. And also in eastern Oregon, a few decades later, range wars broke out between those who grazed sheep and those who grazed cattle, wreaking devastation. The book tells all about the stories of burned barns and fences torn down. Oregon has been one of the few states in which the federal government reclaimed a major chunk of land that had moved into private hands because of massive fraud. I'm referring to the revested O&C lands, former railroad lands. 2.8 million acres were recovered and are managed to this day as the O&C lands. Somewhat earlier, in 1892, Oregon had a tart-tongued populist governor, Sylvester Pennoyer, who characterized incoming President Grover Cleveland, a Democrat, as, quote, a Wall Street plutocrat, unquote. He said all sorts of things like that. And Shanghaiing was then going on in Oregon ports, and Portland claimed to have the world's longest bar, Erickson's on Lower Burnside. It styled itself, quote, as the rowdiest working man's bar in the country, unquote. Later burned down. In World War I, the U.S. Army took over the spruce mills here to guarantee that wood was provided to build fighter planes so that labor strife didn't interfere. In the process, the International Workers of the World, the IWW, was crushed and replaced, quote, by the Loyal Legion of Loggers and Lumbermen, unquote, which management put forth. In World War II, one of the camps in Oregon for conscientious objectors evolved into a camp for artists and poets, and is one of the few known as, quote, a fine arts camp. It was in Waldport. One of the world's largest wooden structures is in Tillamook to this day, a Navy blimp station from World War II, all of 21 stories tall. Now, a little more on the serious side, let's look at something that was called the Oregon System. In the Progressive Era, 1902 to 1919, Oregon led the way nationally with many innovations in governance and social policy, the initiative, the referendum, the recall, the direct primary, women's suffrage, and the Corrupt Practices Act, and also on wage and hour laws for workers, and the Workmen's Compensation Act. Throughout the country, these innovations, which originated here, was known as the Oregon System, and many other states followed Oregon's lead and adopted various measures of that sort too. Later, Oregon returned to innovation and picked up this pattern again and led the nation once more in adopting such things as voting by mail. We now lead the nation with the most of its people that vote each year. And also providing medical insurance for all, and the Death with Dignity program, as well as various Fair Employment Acts and Fair Housing Act and Public Accommodations Act. Let's tarry a moment now to think about the role that Oregon played in the nation's wars. In the Civil War, Oregon had the only U.S. senator killed as a soldier in that war, Senator and Colonel Edward Baker of Oregon at Ball's Bluff, Virginia in 1861. In the Spanish-American War, Oregon's 2nd Volunteer Regiment was federalized in 1898 and sent to the Pacific Theater. Oregon's regiment was the first to land in Guam, the first to land in the Philippines, and then it stayed there and saw that contest to an end. In World War I, Oregon's 41st Infantry Division was the first National Guard of all to be called upon to mobilize and to report. In World War II, the attack by Japanese submarines on Fort Stevens in Oregon was the first foreign attack on a U.S. fortification on this continent in 130 years. Nowhere else in the country, here. And in that war, Oregon's National Guard unit again was the first to go overseas after war was declared. It served longer overseas than any other unit in the U.S. Army and captured and killed more enemy while in the Pacific than any other. In one engagement, it fought continuously for 76 days and came to be known as the Jungleers. Enough of that. Now, shifting to the subject of natural resources and agriculture, Oregon is still the leading state in the amount of lumber it produces, even though it's far less than it used to, 4.2 billion board feet in 2013. Oregon is also the center of the shrimp industry on the West Coast. Newport styles itself as, quote, the Dungeness crab capital of the world, unquote. Oregon is the leading grower of prunes and plums, blackberries, and various seed grasses, such as fescue, bent, and rye grasses. Altogether, Oregon grows almost 250 specialty crops. It also is the leading state in the amount of its crops that it sells directly to customers at farmers' markets. 16% are sold here versus 6% average nationally for other states. But Oregon is, of course, now moving to new specialties such as grapes and wines. It is third in the nation in the amount of wine produced here at over 900 vineyards. It's Pinot Noir. Wines are world-class wines, which wine experts avow are, quote, second to none, unquote. To some extent, Oregon's beginning more to resemble California, with its wines and cheeses being heralded. Now even olive oil is produced here. You can believe it. It has the country's largest producer of iris, Shriners, north of Salem, and the largest producer of dahlias, Swan Island near Canby, the largest in the world. Shifting the focus a little, Oregon puts fewer of its people in jail. Oregon is among the one-third of the states having a low rate of incarceration. Among other things, this reflects the lower rates of murder and violent crime in Oregon. And more of its people give to charity than they do on the average nationally. For instance, the largest food drive in the nation originated in Eugene by the National Association of Letter Carriers. A different subject now is data on the use of cars. Drivers in Oregon use seat belts more than in any other state. Oregon was the first state to keep track of traffic fatalities, and its rate of traffic fatalities is now below the national average. Oregon was also the first state to levy taxes on gas, 1919, to raise the funds to pave its roads and get the traffic out of the mud. Its Department of Transportation has the best record for bringing in its construction projects under budget. It's the least expensive state in which to own and operate a car. And Eugene was the place where the national practice began of using one-way streets to reduce congestion. Oregon was also the place where the idea originated of using the ending numbers on license plates to ration gas when it was in short supply. Many states throughout the nation used that system. Oregon started it. Shifting the focus now to historic preservation. The largest collection of cast iron buildings outside of New York City is found in Portland's Skidmore Old Town Historic District. And most of that iron came from the foundry right here in Lake Oswego. Portland also has one of the greatest collections of commercial buildings clad with glazed terracotta, the Great Wall of White, mostly designed by famous architect A.E. Doyle. The main train station in Portland is the second oldest one still in operation in the nation. The Superintendent's House in Munson Valley in Crater Lake National Park is still in its original condition, and it's admired as one of the best examples in the country of rustic park architecture. Oregon is also preserving historic lodges, of course, at Timberline Lodge, Multnomah Falls, and at Oregon Caves. I should add that Timberline Lodge is notable in another respect. It's the only major park-like lodge owned entirely by the federal government instead of by concessionaires that hold them with a possessory interest. Now, historically, its businesses have been known nationally. Astoria was once, quote, the fishing capital of the world, unquote. Oregon is still the state producing the most lumber. Plywood was invented here. White Stag introduced skiing clothes to the country and became the largest producer. Janssen became a leading producer of swimwear. In the 1930s, Meyer and Frank became the largest retail outlet west of the Mississippi. And during World War II, Portland was regarded as, quote, the Liberty Ship Capital of the country, unquote. Today, Portland is the nation's largest wheat export hub. And Portland is the second most active center on the West Coast for hauling and distributing freight. Its airport is usually top ranked in the country, 15 years running as the nation's best airport. People have been coming to Portland in record numbers for the past quarter century. Oregon also has many top-rated golf courses. Powell's now is the world's largest bookstore. And Wieden and Kennedy is the largest independent advertising agency and the most honored one. The New York Times says maps made in Medford by Raven Maps are, quote, the most beautiful maps made in the United States, unquote. But Oregon's economy is most driven by being foremost in two categories. The world's largest producer of athletic shoes is here, Nike, with most of its competitors gathered here as well to make Oregon what has been described, quote, as the global epicenter of athletic apparel, unquote. With 700 firms of that form, of that sort, rather, now found here. 700. Oregon is also the world center for fabricating computer chips and servicing the needs of the computer industry. A knowledgeable spokesman for a recent governor said Oregon, quote, is the dominant high-tech manufacturing center in the world, unquote. In Washington County, Intel has built the largest collection of chip-producing plants in the world. Well, at the same time that Oregon was developing a dynamic new economy, it was also becoming a leader in cleaning up its environment and conserving nature. It is widely considered to be the greenest state in terms of having programs to protect its environment. Oregon was the first state to set up an agency to clean up its air. It was the first state to actually clean up a major river. It is the only state with a statewide system of land use planning. It was the first jurisdiction in the world to ban CFCs to protect the ozone layer. It was the first state to adopt a mandatory bottle deposit law, which has cleaned up litter along our highways. It's among the top states in recycling, energy efficiency, installed wind capacity, and its reliance on renewables. It's among the best states in the number of charging stations it provides for electric vehicles. It's also among the few states that has virtually ruled out coal and nuclear from its future energy mix. Now, with respect to conserving nature, Oregon was, of course, a pioneer in protecting its beaches and assuring public access. It has the most federally designated wild rivers where dams aren't allowed. But some of its new industries help too. Oregon now hosts the largest plants in the country producing solar panels, and its only plant producing streetcars. It also hosts the U.S. offices of the largest producer of those huge wind turbines. Well, all the while, when these things were happening for both to both the economy and to the environment, culture and entertainment have been thriving in Oregon as well. It's music, live theater, public television, and restaurants are all drawing plaudits across the country. Oregon's Shakespeare Festival down in Ashland is the oldest of this kind in America and recently won a Tony Award. The Portland Center Stage also won a Tony Award in 2013. Portland's Rose Festival has been named, quote, as the best in the world, unquote, by the International Festival and Events Association. Oregon Public Broadcasting has won both a Peabody Award and an Emmy. Its public broadcasting services are the most used in the country and draw the most public support of all of them. Oregon libraries attract one of the largest clientels in the country, the second greatest on an actual basis. And on a per capita basis, Portland Central Library has the highest use in the country. Portland has the most breweries for craft beer of any city in the world. In the world. It's been called, quote, the great new American food city, unquote, with many of its chefs winning the coveted James Beard Award, and its food carts are also celebrated. Portland has also been listed as one of America's most livable cities. It's almost hard to believe that all of these experts in the East rave so much about Portland and Oregon, but I've been quoting them. It's a fact that Oregon has now arrived at a new level of excellence. It's attracting attention from qualified authorities and is being given high marks. While it's far from perfect, the recognition it's getting is simply astonishing. And its new economy has emerged while it's been forging a role as an environmental leader. The two do seem to be compatible. In most ways, Oregon seems to have arrived. Thank you for listening to me.